Eberhard Diepgen, born in Berlin in 1941, grew up in the district of Gesundbrunnen in a housing estate called Atlantic Garden City, built by the architect Rudolf Frenkel. From there to his not unimportant role as a custodian of transatlantic relations, his path went straight. Already during studying law in the Free University of Berlin, the Protestant Christian joined the Christian Democratic Union Party in 1962. In addition to his work as a lawyer, he quickly took on high-ranking positions in party and city politics, was a member of the Berlin House of Representatives from 1971 to 2001, and twice in these 30 years governing major of Berlin. During the pre-reunification period from 1984 to 1989 and after the reunification from 1991 to 2001. He received the Order of Merit of the State of Berlin and the title of City Elder, among many other awards. The 3rd of October was a Wednesday, with the entry of the German Democratic Republic to the Federal Republic of Germany, the reunification was formally completed. How did your working life change from the 2nd to the 4th of October? At that time, you were chairman of the parliamentary group of the Christian Democratic Union in the Berlin House of Representatives and thus leader of the opposition.
We were preparing for the elections right away, and the decisive change was that Berlin officially had become bigger. The difference became apparent later when I took office as governing mayor. I always thought I knew Berlin, but then you could see that Berlin was bigger, that you could visit Berlin more intensive, and that I had to look at the city map from time to time to take a closer look at certain projects. And it was above all the examination of the question of how a city grows together. Berlin, the city of four powers, the western part in constant confrontation with the claims of the Soviet Union, which wanted to capture Berlin, in fact all the GDR, in a close connection to the protecting powers, especially the Americans. And on the other hand, in East Berlin, a concentration point of the communist elites. That was the point. And the work has changed in the sense that first of all everything had to be put back together again. The subway, the S-Bahn, the sewage system, the school system had to be unified. Partly never built up, but I stick to it, the main task was to bring people together. The differences were greater than I thought, than me and old Berliner could actually imagine. And the work was above all to ensure that there were no social eruptions in the amount of changes, and also because of the economic difficulties that both parts of the city were experiencing. That was the 3rd of October.
Your first term as governing major of Berlin ended in early 1989, a good 9 months before the fall of the wall. 3 months after reunification in January 1991, you were re-elected governing major of Berlin. What changes had taken place with regard to the influence of the occupying powers, and especially the USA?
Es ist Menschen von heute kaum klar zu machen, welche.
It is hard to make clear to a person of today what legal status, what legal problems there were in Berlin at the time. The four power status was the continuation and observance of a legal position from 1945. And I want to make that clear at one point. The air corridors were determined by the technology of 1945, and the air corridors, the only free access from the west to the western part of the city of Berlin that could only be used by Allied aircraft, were only allowed to be used at a low altitude. With the new technology, it was always a bumpy flight. And just to make this clear at one point, and by the way, because there was a legal position in 1945, the death penalty was only abolished after reunification. It was never applied, but those were the points. As the governing mayor, it was part of my routine that I had to show up 10 hut to the Allied city commanders every month. I say show up 10 hut, we'll say to make a report. They knew everything, it was all in the newspapers. And then we had a nice conversation. Because there was a change, there was indeed the supreme power of the Allies with substantial influence from the Americans, but the practice developed where the Allies and the Americans were actually only involved in security matters. For example, in questions of police organization up to and including personnel issues, and in questions of security with regards to supplies. Today I always remind of the issue of gas pipelines, because at that time there was already a gas pipeline from the Soviet Union to Berlin via the Federal Republic of Germany in order to secure supplies here. This is quite interesting for current disputes on this point, but the Americans interfered in that very point. For example, they wanted a large storage facility to be built in Berlin, storing a reserve for more than 2 years. I had my controversies with the Americans there. By the way, you could also fight that out. I was of the opinion that if after 6 months they did not succeed in getting it resolved with the Russians, then there was no point to any of it anyway. But the Allies' rights were there and very close cooperation developed. And that all fell away afterwards. Even the dependencies in the process too, the dependencies if I may or may not meet with Mr. Honecker, the party leader of the Communists. I always coordinated this carefully with the Allies in detail, sometimes even controversially, and there were certainly points in detail. But a cooperation did develop, for example, that the Americans had an interest in Berlin making economic progress. With the support of the Americans, I made business trips, acquisition trips, in detail. So the occupying powers developed into allies and friends. And that was the point. And with the reunification on the day of October 3rd, the Allied city commander said goodbye. There was only military left, in detail, and there was a new dependence that was to the German federal government. So more involvement in the federal government. Completely different dependencies, but it was a city in sovereignty of the German decision.
The special closeness strengthened the friendly relationship between West Berlin and the United States of America. Which changes of this relationship between Berlin and the United States did you recognize on the political level?
Ich will mal erst beschreiben das Verhältnis der alten Westberliner zu den Amerikanern. Das war die Schutzmacht.
Let me first describe the relationship between the old West Berliners and the Americans. They were the protecting power. There were also anti-American demonstrations in Berlin from the fundamental opposition. But the old West Berliners had absolutely no understanding for this. By the way, even the Vietnam War was defended more in Berlin than anywhere else in West Germany. The dependence on the Americans for protection against the Soviet Union was very much appreciated. And it was also part of this that American soldiers, for example, became much more involved in Berlin society. And I lived with my children in the American sector at a certain time, and after they had left, we always missed the American soldiers who were training and who would walk past our house, sweating, as it was the case with the training of soldiers. It was a very emotional connection, and at times even mockingly said the American city commander was something like he held court in Berlin. The British deliberately held court somewhat more strongly than the Americans with protocol and the like, but it was, and the Berliners were also very keen to have the American city commander invite them to do so. So all that was dropped, and we tried to keep up a part of this connection after the removal of this legal link. By the way, this foundation that is responsible for this film here is a result of this. We have tried to maintain and develop these many personal contacts. In the past, however, a large number of GIs were stationed here, and once they left, the connection and the memory of Berlin, of Germany to Berlin, has remained. This has brought about a close emotional bond, both on the Berlin side and on the American side. It then became a little less. We had to make an effort, and if I take it to the political level, American interest in Europe has decreased. And the willingness to criticize in Germany or the question of what understanding we have of certain constitutional structures in the United States has become more critical. There are also other elements involved. I immediately apologize for the comment, but in America it has become increasingly clear in recent times, also in the traditions, that there is a fundamentalism in America and that there are Pilgrim Fathers and the Wild West. And by the way, in the last 3 years of American foreign policy, this has also become increasingly clear, partly in domestic policy. You can see that from the reaction here. That's why this willingness to follow America without criticism, almost uncritical, in many parts of Berlin is off.
What are your expectations and wishes for today?
Ich wünsche mir, dass die Fülle der menschlichen Kontakte, der freundschaftlichen Beziehungen, der Briefkontakte, aber auch der persönlichen Besuche, die es immer noch gibt.
I wish that the abundance of human contacts, of friendly relations, of pen pals, but also of personal visits, which still exist, will not only remain, but will be further developed and transferred to a next generation. In America, against the background of legal responsibilities in the municipalities, that is, with the mayors concerning town winning, not quite as expandable as it is with other countries. But the contact of organizations, church communities, the contact of universities, these organizations are a basis for understanding. They are important when things don't work out well between the big wigs in government in Berlin and Washington, D.C. Then it can and must work on the other level. This has already helped to overcome many crises, and it must be maintained after America. That's why I have always been concerned that certain forms of organization, such as the Rias Commission, Checkpoint Charlie, the Aspen Institute, the American Academy here in Berlin, that they all are also actively working on German-American relations. And by the way, I must also make this remark that they are not hindered by American government agencies.
Please tell us the story behind selected photography.
Na, das war die 750-Jahr-Feier. Da ging es übrigens darum, dass das Engagement der Alliierten in Berlin auch ihre Unterstützung.
That was the 750th anniversary celebration of Berlin. Incidentally, the point was that the visits demonstrated the commitment of the Allies in Berlin and their support for the city of Berlin, and that it became clear that this is not a celebration of two divided cities, East and West. But the picture here, of course, also reminds us that this was the year 1987, with a legendary speech that, of course, was not given at the toast of President Reagan's cutting the cake, but which was held shortly before that at the Brandenburg Gate. Tear down this wall. By the way, not only this point, there were four different points. And it reminds me, although that Reagan was once completely misunderstood in Europe, there were violent demonstrations against him here in Berlin, to my great annoyance. And as I sat there at the Brandenburg Gate, I was with my thoughts, and because of the information that came to me, even with the demonstrators who were rioting less than a kilometer away. The meaning of the speech was recognized then at the latest 1 year later. Also somewhat sarcastically said, when Reagan gave his speech, he was the cold warrior who didn't have a clue about politics, and already a few months later he was the greatest visionary.
Rede ist ja dann spätestens ein Jahr danach richtig erkannt worden. Also auch mal etwas spöttisch gesagt, als Reagan diese Rede gehalten hat, war er der kalte Krieger und der von Politik, also versteht überhaupt nichts davon, dieser Mensch. Und schon wenige Monate danach war er der große Visionär.